From the Alberta Festival, the BBC presents a program of opera given by the English Opera Group. The first part is devoted to a performance of Venus and Adonis by John Blow. But before the curtain rises, here is Alec Robertson to tell you something about the opera.
Venus and Adonis, as its title suggests, must be one of the most difficult operas to cast as regards the two principals. For though we expect singers to have beautiful voices, it's a pleasant surprise when they also have beautiful faces, or at any rate adequate faces, to match. The difficulty is being very pleasantly solved at the Alberta Festival this year in the persons of Heather Harper, a young soprano from Belfast who's rapidly making a name for herself, and Thomas Helmsley, a bass, who's already made a name for himself. Blow's Venus and Adonis is the earliest extant genuine English opera. It was called a masque, but it is in fact a true opera in miniature. Blow composed it about 1685 for the private entertainment of the king, Charles II, and the part of Venus was sung by the king's mistress, the one who happened to be favored at the time, Mrs. Mary Davis, and Cupid was sung by her daughter, who was little more than 12 years old then, and must have been an excellent little musician to cope with her part. The opera, as Professor Dent says, is far too intimate and delicate for an ordinary opera house. So the Jubilee Hall at Alberta is really a perfect place for it. It may be a small work, but there's no mistake at all about the poignance of its emotions, and it has some delightfully humorous moments as well. Its most striking characteristic, says Dent, is the way in which it quite suddenly passes from frivolity to tragedy. There can be no doubt that it served as the model for Purcell's Dido and Aeneas, and Purcell, you may remember, was a pupil of John Blow's and succeeded him as organist to Westminster Abbey in 1679. The story, which is very familiar in Shakespeare's poem, is slight, and there's not a great deal of action. The first of the three short acts, after the act tune, as the preludes were called, begins with a love scene between Venus and Adonis, which is broken into by the hunter's music. Venus is anxious that Adonis shouldn't tire of lovemaking, and so she urges him to go hunting. He refuses at first. Adonis will not hunt today, he says. But after the lively hunter's chorus, come follow to the noblest game, and a solo by one of the huntsmen about the joy of fighting a wild boar, he consents and bids farewell to Venus. The curtain comes down to the singing and dancing of the huntsmen. It rises in Act Two, after the act tune, on the charming scene of Venus and Cupid surrounded by the little Cupids. Cupid's tuneful solo is followed by the lesson for the little Cupids. This is a delightfully humorous scene, because they learn to spell a word that has been bothering them, and the word is mercenary. It's a reference to the, as the text says, the insolent, arrogant, and mercenary ones who scorn love. And so Cupid spells out the word, syllable by syllable, and then they repeat it after him. Another melodious solo for Cupid leads to a dance for the little Cupids and that to a chorus and dance of the Graces, one of the most attractive numbers in the score. On this, the curtain falls. After the act tune to act three, the curtain rises to disclose Venus in a melancholy posture, for Adonis has not yet returned from the hunt, and she is sighing for him in very realistic vocal phrases. Presently, he's led in, wounded to death, in combat with a wild boar. She cries out in anguish as he dies in her arms, and the music here is most poignant. The opera ends with a very beautiful solo for Venus and chorus, beginning with the lines, with solemn pomp let mourning Cupids bear my soft Adonis through the yielding air. Some of the music in the opera is merely formal, and perhaps not very many of the frequent tunes and arioso passages are really memorable, as Purcell's nearly always are. And yet, there's much that's really fresh and individual in the little work. particularly in the part of Venus. This contains a good deal of realistic word painting, such as her laugh at the Cupids in the spelling lesson, and the exact opposite, her mourning cries in the death scene. The version of the opera used in the performance we're going to hear has been edited with loving care by Imogen Holst. And I think I can promise you that we're going to enjoy this miniature opera enormously.